God, welcome to the Power Hour, the Word of God. Once again, I'm going to be sharing a little bit more on Mormonism because I didn't get to finish all of it last time. But I want Mormons to pay really, really close attention to Scripture, like I told you last week. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved is the power of God. The power of God and what He accomplished on the cross of Calvary when He became a man, died for our sins. Praise God. He's what it's all about. Okay, I'm going to be sharing some more on Mormonism and I'm going to try to carry, when I left and I got home, I realized I didn't keep my word and tell you where to look to find out about how Joseph Smith died. So I want to start out with giving you the information there. I told you that Joseph Smith didn't die a martyr for Jesus Christ. He died in a gunfight. He died John Wayne style. He killed two people and wounded a third one before they got him. He probably would have got somebody every time, but he got three misfires on his gun. But anyway, that's in History of the Church, Volume 6, pages XLI. And 618 at the back of the book. Okay, it's also in volume 7 on pages 103 through 106. Check it out. And I'd love to talk to you. Give me a call. Okay, now this time when we talk about a few different miscellaneous items in the Book of Mormon. And I'm going to talk about regarding skin color first. In 2 Nephi chapter 5 verses 20 through 25, it says this. I'll be quoting. Wherefore, the word of the Lord was fulfilled, which he spake in me, saying, that inasmuch as they did not hearken to thy words, they shall be cut off from the presence of the Lord. And behold, they were cut off from his presence. And he had caused his cursing to come upon them, yea, even a sore cursing, because of their iniquity. And behold, they had hardened their hearts against him, and they had become like a flint. Wherefore, as they were white and exceedingly fair and delightsome, that they were enticing unto my people, the Lord God did cause a skin of blackness to come upon them. And thus saith the Lord God, I will cause that they shall be loathsome unto my people, say they repent of their iniquities. And cursed shall be their seed be of him that mixes with their seed. For they shall be cursed with the same cursing. And the Lord God spake it, and it was done. And because of their cursing which was upon them, they did become an idle people, full of mischief and subtlety, and did seek in the wilderness for beasts of prey. And the Lord God said to me, they shall be a scourge unto thy seed, and to stir them up in remembrance of me. And inasmuch as they did not remember me, and hearken unto my words, they shall be a scourge, even unto destruction. Okay? Now, what I just read to you, the Lord God, it said in this book, it says in the Book of Mormon, it says he caused the skin of blackness to come upon them. All through Mormon history, Brigham Young preached it for over 25 years that the black race was a cursed race, as with the Indians. But anyway, so he said the lighter your skin was, the whiter you are, you're pure and delightsome, you know. I'm kind of pure and delightsome, but I'm not enough. But anyway, but what I want to tell you, Jesus Christ was a Jew. He wasn't an American. That's why I got this song. You know, it said Jesus, and it got USA, it says Jesus saves. And USA in the middle. But Jesus is not an American God. He's a God of the universe. He's a God of everything. He's a God of the world. He wasn't born in America. He was born overseas. And he wasn't white and delightsome, so-called, as the Mormons call it. So I want to tell you about the curse in the Mormon church. They're trying to get away from it now. And what they're doing, they're changing their Book of Mormon continually to line up with their newfound beliefs, okay? So I'm going to be quoting you two quotes, one from the 1980 Book of Mormon, I have at home, and the Triple Combination, which is a 1981 Book of Mormon in the Triple Combination. That's where they got the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price all in one book, okay? But anyway, in the 1980 Book of Mormon, 2 Nephi chapter 30, verse 6 says this, "And then shall they rejoice, for they shall know that it was a blessing in them from the hand of God. And their scales of darkness shall begin to fall from their eyes, and many generations shall not pass away among them, that they shall be a white and delightsome people." Now, what he's saying is, hey, those who accept, these black people, these redskins, whatever other color people skin they are, these kind of people, when they accept the Mormon gospel, they'll become a white and delightsome people, okay? And all through different Mormon books, and I'm not going to be quoting a lot of them because they're not really standard works of the Mormon church. As you said, well, Dan, that's not scripture. The Mormons are having their people mixed with the blacks or with the whites, I mean the Indians or whatever, and they're coming up with kids and they got a little bit lighter skin. Well, of course you do. If a white man marries a black man or a woman or a vice versa, then the skin color is going to be a little bit lighter or darker based on whatever genes they get from the parents. But anyway, so I said, okay, now let's look at the 1981 Book of Mormon in the triple combination. Here's what it says. I said they're slowly getting away from their prejudice attitude and by changing their book. And here's what it says in that verse right toward the end that I quoted in the other one. And many generations shall not pass away, and they shall be a pure and delightsome people. They changed the white and delightsome to pure and delightsome, okay? Now they're trying to convince you that, hey, we're not talking about skin color, Danny. We're talking about his quality. No, I said, no, you weren't. You never were. Brigham Young, for 20 years, cut the black race, the Indians. He totally cut them in his sermons. He said they were an idle people full of mischief and subtlety. All this kind of junk. He continued to cut the black man. Said they were, you know, they wasn't much more than a monkey, just like Charles Darwin believed, okay? So they believed it, and they've always taught it, and now they're getting away from it because in 1970... I'm guessing now, I think it's 73. Spencer W. Kimball was president of the Mormon Church. And they were building temples like in South America and stuff like that. Well, there's a lot of black blood mixed in with the white blood. Well, the Mormons had to do something. So Spencer W. Kimball supposedly went before God and started praying, seeking God's face. And, hey, God, come on, forgive them, Jesus. You know, let them enter our church, okay? And all this stuff. And supposedly God repented of his prejudice attitude. I guess he did. But anyway, then... So Spencer W. Kimball got this new revelation that the blacks could finally enter into the Mormon temple. I said, well, isn't that cool? But Brigham Young said, when 1 ounce of black blood enters the Mormon temple, the true church is taken from this planet and God leads her to our faith, okay? So Brigham Young, which was an apostle and a prophet and a president of the Mormon church, would totally disagree. He said, no, it can't happen. He said, it can never happen while we're here. All the white people got to get it first, is what he was telling you. Okay, so now... I wanted to emphasize that, but now I want to get into some other, what I call fairly ridiculous comments that I read in the Book of Mormon. When I have Mormon missionaries, when they come to my door, when I'm out on the streets, I'm driving around and I see them, I pull over. If I'm on a bicycle, if I'm in my car, I pull over and talk to them if they'll talk with me. And I was doing that a lot when I was living in Nampa mostly. But anyway, they're... you know, bishops and whatever, when they found out they talked to me, they told them not to talk to me anymore. So now usually they won't talk to me, but they just said, don't waste your time with them. And I said, man, I'm not trying to cause any problems. I said, if you got the truth, I want to hear it. And if I got the truth, you should want to hear it. I said, the truth says it's free. I'm not ashamed of it, and I'm not afraid of it. Why should you be? So anyway, now I'm going to show you a few little different examples in the Book of Mormon, because they tell me the Book of Mormon lines up with the Word of God, the Bible, okay? They say it goes hand in hand with it. Well, and then they say the Book of Mormon is totally pure and perfect in every way, okay? Well, I ask them, I said, well, when you tell me it's pure and perfect, which one are you talking about? You talking about the one that Joe Smith came out with before the 4,000 changes, or the one they have today? There's over 4,000 changes in the Book of Mormon. They're different books now. They're different doctrinally. They all kinds of different changes in them. And I said, but I want to show you, I want to share some things they haven't changed in the Book of Mormon yet. And I think they're kind of... they're crazy, and I ask Mormon missionaries to explain them to me, and they can't, or they don't, or they come up with, man, wait till you hear an answer he gave me on one of these. I'm gonna share that with you in a minute. But anyway, now let's listen to 4th Nephi, chapter 1, verse 6, which says, quoting, and thus did the, now remember, I want you to remember something before I read this. The Book of Mormon was supposedly chiseled by on the gold plates. They were chiseling these letters, okay? Now think about that. That's a hard, tedious work. They were chiseling all these letters in the gold plates as they're writing this Book of Mormon. Now, watch this. I'm going to give you an example. I said, I'm going to see if that lives up to what I read in the Book of Mormon. I'm just going to give you one example for time. In 4th Nephi chapter 1, verse 4, and thus did the 38th year pass away, and also the 39th, and the 41st, and the 42nd. Yea, even to the 49 years had passed away, and also did the 51st and the 52nd. Yea, and even until 59 years had passed away. People, I want to tell you something. Now, he's chiseling. Now, remember, he's chiseling these letters in gold plates, dude. I said, wasn't it, dude? I said, listen to me, Mormon. I said, they took 57 words to say 59 years passed away. I said, you know, that's hard for me to believe. You're saying that you're chiseling all these letters in gold. 57 words, and they could have easily said 59 years passed away. That's all he said. He didn't say nothing else. He just said 59 years passed away. Okay, so I was reading in Esther, chapter 15, verses 30 and 31. And it came to pass that when Cor Timur had leaned upon his sword and he had rested a little, he smote off the head of Shiz. Now, Shiz is the mean guy in the Book of Mormon, okay? And it came to pass that after he had smitten off the head of Shiz, that Shiz raised up on his hands and fell. After he had struggled for breath, he died. I was sharing with some Mormon missionaries. I was at a, I've had them pull over, and I was talking to them, and I brought this up. And I said, could you explain this to me? I've only had one Mormon give me any kind of answer to it. He said, well, Danny, haven't you ever seen it when you cut off a chicken? You cut off a chicken's head, he jumps around and all this kind of stuff. I said, well, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but I'm going to read this to you again because I don't think you heard what I said. I said, I know what a chicken does and I know why a chicken does it, but let's find out about this guy Shiz. And it came to pass that after he had smitten off the head of Shiz, that Shiz raised up on his hands, you listening to me, and fell. After that, he had struggled for breath. Those chickens aren't struggling for breath. She has pushed up on his hands to struggle for breath without a head. I said, I want you to think about it. You know. Anyway, that's the only answer I really ever got from Mormon missionaries, and I've shared with a lot of them. But I said, I like to bring any false religious system or whatever. I bring the New Agers into it. I said, what you need to do is do like the New Agers do. Just visualize it. You know, I see these bumper stickers all the time. Visualize peace. I can visualize peace until I fall over dead. Peace won't come by me visualizing it, okay? In other words, these Mormons can visualize Shiz pushing up on his hands to catch his breath. It'll never happen. I don't care how much you visualize it. It'll never, ever, ever happen, okay? Now let's go to Alma. I'm going to share something with you in Alma chapter 44, verses 13 through 16, quoting. And it came to pass that the soldier who stood by, who smote off the scalp of Zerahemnah, took the scalp off the ground by the hair and laid it upon the point of his sword and stretched it forth unto them, saying to them with a loud voice, even as this scalp has fallen unto the earth, which is the scalp of your chief, so shall ye fall to the earth, except you will deliver up your weapons of war and depart with a covenant of peace. Now there were many when they heard these words and saw the scalp which was upon the sword and were struck with fear. And many came forth and threw down their weapons of war at the feet of Moroni. Moroni is a good dude in the Book of Mormon, okay? And he departed into a covenant of peace. And as many as entered into the covenant, they suffered to depart into the wilderness. And it came to pass that Zerahemnah, you remember who he is, don't you? That Zerahemnah was exceeding wroth. And he did stir up the remainder of the soldiers to anger to contend more powerfully against the Nephites. I don't know if y'all found what's happening here. Now, Zerahemnah got the top of his head chopped off, okay? And this Moroni got it on the point of his sword. I mean, he's got this scalp, you know what I mean? He's got skin and all his head. It's all right here. But then it says, it came to pass that Zerahemnah, that's the one that doesn't have the top of his head. He fights more powerfully than before. He's really mad. I guess I would be too. If I didn't have a top of my head, I'd be fighting bad too, okay? I said, think about what you're reading in this, and you're comparing it to the Word of God. And anyway, so I love the Mormon. I keep saying over and over and over, I share all these kind of principles. I've been to a lot of Mormon wards, probably most of them around here, Boise, Napa, Caldwell, you name it. I've been to a lot of Mormon houses talking to different Mormons and stuff. I love those people. I hate the system. The system is total stupidity. It's nonsense. It's leading them astray. But anyway, now this next one I'm going to share with you is from Alma, chapter 30, verse 53. Now this one is really, really important for the Mormon to hear and listen to, okay? For behold, the devil hath deceived me. For he hath appeared to me in the form of an angel and said unto me, go and reclaim this people, for they have gone astray after an unknown God. Now remember, the devil deceived him. He came in the form of an angel, is what the Book of Mormon says. And telling him to go after an unknown God. And he said to me, there is no God, yea, and I have taught me that I should say that I have taught his words, and I taught them because they were pleasing to the carnal mind. And I taught them, even until I had much success, inasmuch as I verily believed that they were true. And for this cause I withstood the truth. Even to I had brought it to pass this great curse upon me. You see what he's saying now? He said, man, I preached this thing. I had an angel. I had a devil in the form of an angel come to me and give me this message. and I preached it because of all the fame and the fortune and the money and everything it brought to me, that fits Joseph Smith to a T, okay? Now, he said, man, I believed it. I preached it so much that I really believed what I was preaching, is what he's saying. So in other words, I want you to really pay attention to that. Not only does the Word of God line up with this, as far as the devil taking the form of an angel or a man, whatever. The Bible says in Galatians 6, if we or any other angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than which we preach, let him be accursed, okay? Even if an angel from heaven comes and preaches you a different gospel that's in this word, you reject it in the name of Jesus, okay? So in other words, this devil that was in the form of an angel got him to believe it. It's the same way with Mormonism. The Mormons, I've heard this over and over and over. They forced themselves to believe it. And I'm going to show you exactly why, too. But anyway, just a minute. So really think about what I'm trying to say. Does it do? It pleases the carnal mind, especially of the men. I mean, if you're in a Mormon church, men, they got the power and the authority in the man church. In other words, they can marry all these women. There's at least, by statistics, you can read it on the web or whatever, newspapers or whatever you want to read it. There's at least 100,000 Mormons living in polygamy today. 100,000. Because they know the only way they're become a god or a son of God is by entering into polygamy, plural marriage. They got to have at least two women or more, okay, as wives. So anyway, I said, but what's really interesting about this, I don't know if y'all ever heard of a movie, it's called The Godmakers. But anyway, Ed Decker was a good friend of mine that did the movie. But anyway, that movie, it showed all these Mormons that they realized, they came to the fact that Mormonism was false, okay? But when you're in a town or an area that's full of Mormons and they control a lot of businesses, they control a lot of the stuff that's going on, those Mormons that know the truth won't get out because they don't want to lose their family, their friends, their job, or whatever. So they just stick in it. And that's happened over and over, too. So anyway, so I'm going to show you something. Now, this part is going to get a little bit boring to a lot of people because I'm going to do a lot of quoting from different books or saying something where the books are found. But first, I need to tell you what Joseph Smith said. Joseph Smith said this, I told the brethren that the Book of Mormon was the most correct of any book on earth and the keystone of our religion. And a man would get near to God by abiding by his precepts, that's doctrines in any other book. That's located in Teachings of the Prophet Joseph Smith on page 194. Now, he said, I told all the brethren that you're going to get closer to God if you live by this Book of Mormon. If you live by it, you practice it, okay? Now, so when I said that, I asked Mormon missionaries, I asked bishops, I asked all kinds of Mormons these questions, and they don't give me answers. I said, based on what you just told me, okay, the Book of Mormon is the most correct book on this planet, okay? Now, where are these teachings found in the Book of Mormon? Not only will you find out they're not in the Book of Mormon, the Book of Mormon teaches this opposite many, many times of Mormon beliefs today. Celestial marriage is for time and eternity. It's called the crowning gospel ordinance required for godhood. Okay, now, that one doctrine right there is super important in Mormonism. It's not taught. It's not taught in the Book of Mormon. Matter of fact, the Book of Mormon teaches this opposite. It teaches one woman for one man for all time is what the Book of Mormon teaches. Celestial marriages makes gods in eternity, according to Mormonism, but the Book of Mormon condemns it. What justifies it? Well, Gospel Through the Ages by Milton R. Hunter on pages 118 and 120, and Doctrines of Salvation by Joseph Fielding Smith on volume 2, page 62. Okay, another one that they have that is super important in Mormonism, very, very important, is called Baptism for the Dead. They call it the most glorious of all subjects pertaining to the everlasting gospel. Where is it found? It's not found in the Book of Mormon. But Joseph Smith said the Book of Mormon is the most correct book on this planet. It brings you near to God. It's got all. Now, we're going to find out something in a minute really cool. So I said, okay, so if baptism for the dead, where is it at? Well, it's in Doctrine and Covenants, section 128, verse 18. Okay, now, the third one, they say that God was once a man as we are now and an exalted man. That's in the Teachings of the Prophet Joseph Smith, and it's compiled by Joseph Fielding Smith on page 345. Now he said that that God was once a man as we are. And I came from Lorenzo Snow a long time ago. He was one of the president's prophets of the church, prophets of it. But anyway, he said it. There's a movie. It just came to me. There's a movie, Battlestar Galactica. Battlestar Galactica, I don't watch TV, but anyway, I saw certain clips a friend showed me to me. They had these beings from this other planet land on this planet, and these are really big guys, you know. They said, they're looking, pointing down at these little earthlings or whatever. As you are, we once were. As we are, you can become. That's Mormonism to a T. In other words, it was preaching Mormonism in Battlestar Galactica. In other words, this guy was pointing down at these little earthlings and said, as you are, we once were. He's pretending this guy, this big guy's a god, okay? So in other words, he taught that as God is, he was once like us, and we can become a god like him, okay, as we go on. Once again, it's not in the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon teaches just the opposite. The Book of Mormon teaches that God is eternal, that God's always been God. Matter of fact, the Book of Mormon, not only, it doesn't really teach a triune God. It teaches God is the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The Son is the Father is the Holy Ghost, is what the Book of Mormon teaches. Okay? Anyway, but it never, ever teaches God is a man. It's nowhere in it. Okay? Now, the next one kind of goes with that one. It says God has the body of flesh and bones. It's not in the Book of Mormon. It's in Doctrine and Covenants too. Section 130:22. That man can become gods. And that's not in the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon teaches the eternal God, that God's always been God. Nobody can become a God. Okay? The Book of Mormon condemns it. The Mormon doctrine is the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are three gods. I already told you. The Book of Mormon teaches a oneness doctrine. Okay? You know? So we keep on going with the doctrine of the plurality of wives, the doctrine of the preexistence, the doctrine of three degrees of glory. None of this stuff, and they're all super important doctrines in Mormonism, none of it's in the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon condemns most of it, okay? So what I tried to get into, I said, well, if that's the case, then why do Mormons believe it? You know, Mormons, when I was sharing with a lot of Mormon missionaries, they said, hey, Danny, have you read the Book of Mormon, prayed about it as a God? I said, the Word of God doesn't tell me to do that. The Bible tells me to test all things, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. I'm called to prove all things. And I've checked your book out with the Bible that doesn't line up. It's not of God. I reject it, okay? In other words, I don't have to pray about it. I asked a Mormon missionary one time. He told me, well, then you need to pray about it. And I said, that ain't how you get answers. I said, have you ever committed adultery? He said, well, no. I said, well, why haven't you? Well, because it's wrong. Well, why is it wrong? Well, I just know it's wrong. Well, how do you know it's wrong? I had to get an answer. I said, how do you know it's wrong? He said, well, I just know, man. I said, how do you know it's wrong? Well, because the Bible condemns it. You gave me the answer I need to hear. The Bible condemns the Book of Mormon because the Book of Mormon doesn't line up with the Bible. Time and time and time again, it contradicts the Word of God. Now, it lines up with the Bible in a lot of places. Why? Because Joseph Smith copied chapter after chapter after chapter of the King James Bible straight into the Book of Mormon, word for word. Even the italicized words in the Bible, the King James translators were honest men. So they italicized a word that wasn't in the original Greek or Hebrew. They italicized those words. And so that would show that they were added to make it flow in English language is all they did, okay? So Joseph Smith just put it in as regular, like it's part of the original Word of God, and it's not. So anyway, but it has to be in the Word to make it flow in our language, okay? That's all. It has to be there. So anyway, but what I was saying, and I've said it over and over and over, that Jesus Christ, the Bible says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, okay? Now, think about that in Mormonism. Mormonism teaches that Jehovah is Jesus and Elohim is God the Father. Elohim is a Hebrew word. Jehovah is a Hebrew word. Jehovah, when you see capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D in the King James Bible, it's Jehovah every time. Every time you see it, it is Jehovah. Okay? When you see God or gods, according to the context it's written in, that's Elohim. Elohim is not somebody's name. Elohim is not God the Father's name. And Jehovah is God. Jehovah is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They're all called Jehovah in the Bible. They're the three in one God. Now, the Bible says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. God is one, yet he's three in one. I'm one, yet I'm three in one. I'm a body, soul, and a spirit, but I'm one man, okay? We are three in one. Space is my favorite type. When Mormons came, they reject the triune God because they can't understand it. I said, there's a lot of things. I can't understand a God that's existed from all eternity to all eternity. He's never had a beginning. I can't understand that, but I know it's true. We don't have to understand with our carnal. We got a little bitty dinky mind, a finite mind. We're going to understand an infinite God. It's not going to happen, people. I said, God's word is true. God's word has never, ever been proven false, and it never will be. They've tried and tried and tried, okay? So, I said, thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, whose heart departeth from the Lord. God says, you're cursed if you trust in man. Trust in God. Trust in the word of God. Trust what he promises he'll do for you, okay? The Bible said, but to as many as received him, to them gave he power, become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. God won't put any, no sin, nothing is too great. God won't put anybody down. He won't put anybody, just come to him in faith and repentance. Say, Jesus, I need you. I realize that you're God Almighty. You came in human flesh. You went through all that you went through on the cross for my sins. God, I can't comprehend it, but I know you did it, Jesus. You know, I've talked to people that said, well, Dan, we don't even know if Jesus is real. I said, man, there's more historical proof that Jesus Christ existed than Hitler did, okay? I mean, all kinds of proof if you want to look for it. Jesus was a real person. He walked this planet. We know that. Anybody that throws that nonsense at me is crazy. So all you have to do is believe him, trust him. He proves himself by his resurrection from the dead. He said, no man takes my life from me. I lay it down willingly. He laid his life down willingly for you and me. And he raised it up the third day, and all that come to him become new creatures. He loves you a lot, praise God. Thanks for tuning in. Jesus loves you. Praise you, God.